what he says. Even if you find your life in this world, this system, in society, you're still going to lose it. Watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments. And they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. And he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. And I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He that have an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. And all the people said. This is a period in Sardis known as the period of Reformation. From 1500 AD, by most scholars and chronologists' estimation, until the mid-1800s. For 300 years or for three centuries, this particular period is referred to in Revelation chapter 3, verses number 1 through verse number 6. It is also known as a period of the Renaissance. For those of you that are graduates of universities and colleges, you have studied this in Western civilization and Western culture. You have heard of a period known as, someone say, the Renaissance. The awakening of Europe to a new interest in literature, art, and science is what the term Renaissance refers to. I will repeat, the awakening of Europe to a new interest in literature, art, and science. Of course, we will get into some of the things that took place during this period known as the Renaissance, such as much of what I'm going to speak of here on tonight from a historical standpoint. This is a carryover from the Middle Ages, but during the Middle Ages arose nearly all the great universities, established mainly by churchmen and growing out of earlier schools connected with the cathedrals and monasteries. Among these are to be named the University of Paris, which in the 11th century under Abelard embraced thousands of students, the University of Oxford and Cambridge, of which Brother Crump attended as a student, and of Bologna, to which students journeyed from all European lands. All the great cathedrals of Europe, those marvels of Gothic architecture upon which the modern world looks, but which it cannot hope to surpass or even equal in our day, were planned and built during the medieval period. The awakening of literature began in Italy with Dante's Divine Comedy, which was began about 1303 and soon followed by the writings of Petrarch and of Boccaccio. Now, I'm simply reading this to update you on some of the things that were going on in society and in academia. Someone say academia, because academia was setting the pace for society in these times, in as much as people were being encouraged to get an education and to get degrees so that they could participate in society on a higher intellectual level. These individuals soon moved up the ladder of success, both economically, academically, and otherwise, to become leaders in the then known world. This was a period of time known as the Renaissance. Classical Greek literature prevailed in that day. Modern science became one of the mainstream teachings of academia in that day. The Renaissance began in Italy as a literary movement. The invention of the printing press took place in 1456 AD. Until that time, there were scribes, and those things that were passed on in literature were passed on by the inkhorn, simply by an individual taking an inkhorn and a vessel of ink and writing and or penning whatever it was that they were going to put in record. But then came the printing press in 1456 AD. the scriptures in the hand of the common men now were being pushed by the reformers, translated and circulated in all languages in Europe, and the spirit of nationality and patriotism began to evolve. Are you listening to me? The Reformation in Germany, just to talk about some of those individuals, you may have read about many of the reformers, but John Wycliffe was one of those who began, or was one of the early reformers in the movement in England for freedom from the Roman power and for reformation in the church. He was born about 1329 AD and was educated at the University of Oxford, where he became and obtained a doctorate of theology and led and was a leading spirit in its councils. He attacked much of the teaching that we talked about earlier. And of course, in other lands, he would have suffered martyrdom, but in England, he was protected by the most powerful among the nobles. John Huss in Bohemia was martyred in 1415 AD and was a reader of Wycliffe's writings. He preached his doctrines, especially proclaiming freedom from papal authority. And of course, he was made rector at the University of Prague. Also, the Reformation in Germany. During the Reformation in Germany, when Martin Luther, as I will get to in a moment, began to emerge as one of your leading reformers, Pope Leo X, needing money to complete what has now become known as St. Peter's Basilica, the largest church in the world today that seats almost 100,000 people. He issued the authority to a man by the name of John Tetzel to sell certificates of indulgence signed by Pope Leo X. Tetzel purported the pardon of sins on certificate holders and friends or relatives who purchased the same. This was to raise money to finish the church. Turn to someone and say, doesn't that sound like Juanita Bynum? I want it on TV too. I'm not playing. Praise the Lord. Tell your neighbor, say foolishness. This is Tetzel's statement and his declaration, quote, "As soon as your coin clinks in the chest, the souls of your friends will rise out of purgatory to heaven," unquote. This is what Martin Luther rebelled against. Luther wrote what became known as a treatise, a 99-page thesis on the justification by faith and the priesthood of all believers. Look it up on the internet or wherever you want to go to study this. He nailed the thesis to the door in Wittenberg, Germany, at the Wittenberg Cathedral on October 31st, 1517 AD. And this began what became known as the Protestant Reformation. Pope Leo X convened a council in which he excommunicated Luther in 1520 AD. And then at the Diet of Spires, 9 years later, the group of those who embraced Luther's writings that were in the Catholic Church, but had embraced Luther's writings because of the teachings of the Catholic Church being out of sync and in conflict with the scriptures, became known as protesters, i.e. Protestants. Then, of course, there was John Calvin, who published the Institute of the Christian Religion in 1536 AD. Then William John Tyndale, an English reformer, was martyred in 1536 AD. John Knox emerged in 1519 and established what became known as the Congregationalist Church. John Wesley, I believe it was, emerged as a reformer and established what became known as the Methodist Church. And then, of course, John Calvin emerged as a reformer later on, around 1544, and established what became known as the Baptist Church. Now, all of this is in church history. I can give you my sources. And, of course, you can look this up if you want to go to Zondervan Bookstore in Grand Rapids. It's all there for the taking and for the pickings of the child of God. The principles of Reformation were the following. Spiritual religion. Religion should be spiritual. Turn to your neighbor and say, religion should be spiritual. rational religion, intelligent, rejecting image worship, personal religion, and national religion. That religion should be integrated in the lifestyle of the totality of the community and of national culture. Are you listening to me? The counter-reformers, the Catholics had an answer for the reformers. They established what became known as the Order of the Jesuits in 1534 AD. The founder of this particular organization was Ignatius Loyola. He is said to be one of the greatest Catholic evangelists that has ever lived in the history of time. Active in persecution, even unto death, for those who opposed the teachings of Catholicism, he traveled all over the known world and converted much of South America, Mexico, large parts of Canada, and India to Catholicism. And those particular Catholic institutions that stand in these places today, many of them can attribute their success and their perpetuity to the evangelism of Ignatius Loyola. There is a university named after him, as a matter of fact. And I have a Catholic preacher here on the front row. Can we say amen? 30 Years' War began in 1618 between Protestants and Catholics. It lasted from 1618 until 1648. Multitudes of Catholics and Protestants lost their lives. If you will remember of recent, there was a peace treaty signed during the Clinton administration between Sinn Féin, who was representing, I think, the Protestants. Maybe he was representing, I don't know which side he was representing. But was he? The Irish Protestants. And then, of course, the Catholics. They signed a peace treaty because the Protestants and Catholics were fighting in that part of the world all the way up until the mid-1990s. I think George Mitchell was involved in negotiating that treaty that stands to this day. Are you listening to me? The Honorable George Mitchell. You might be looking at this former senator, and just in case you are, my number is on the screen. Can we say amen? The Peace Treaty of Westphalia was signed in 1648 to end the 30 Years' War between Catholics and Protestants. Boundaries were fixed by Roman Catholics and Protestants agreeing that certain states would be Catholic states and certain states would be Protestant states. And as a result of this peace treaty, for the most part, they attempted to live in concord and harmony despite their doctrinal and religious differences. And now America today is a country that, according to the Constitution, has allowed us to have freedom of religion, where Congress can make no law that will prohibit or inhibit us from gathering to worship as we will as citizens of this country. Do y'all ever read any of the stuff I'm talking about? Does this make any sense to anybody? It's time to go home. Can the church say amen? The translation of the King James Version came into play in existence in 1604 to 1611 at the command of King James of Great Britain. He ordered, or by decree, requested that 54 Protestant linguists would work on translating the scriptures into the language of the common people. Even though it is true that the King James Version that you have and I have today, whether it be the fourth or fifth edition, is written and or translated into what has become known as Elizabethan English, the English spoken by the Queen of England. It is a higher form of English, yet even though it is a beautiful poetical form of English, it is a bit archaic when we compare it to American English, because we do not speak Elizabethan English in this country. We speak American English. We do not speak in these and thous, yees and yeas. This is how they spoke in that day. And much of what is in our Bible is archaic in terms of the common way in which we speak today. Nevertheless, back in 1611, the 8 years or whatever it was, make sure I got my dates right before I mess around and misquote. Yes, from 1604 to 1611, the 8 years it took or whatever it was for them to translate it into the English language, Elizabethan English, that is, you should understand that they had not had the scriptures in their hands until the translation of the King James Version. Yes, there was the John Wycliffe Bible. There was the William Tyndale Bible. There was the Bishop's Bible. There was the Jerome Bible. I can go down and almost name all of them. There were some dozen Bibles out there that had, in fact, been translated by individuals for the purpose of putting it into the hands of the common people. However, it did not have the sanction of the king. It did not have the sanction of the emperor. It did not have the blessing of the pope. Therefore, those who were in Catholic lands who were caught with a Bible, in most cases, would lose their life. But when King James of Great Britain issued his decree for the scriptures to be translated into the language of the common people, 54 linguists came together for to consider this matter. And it is said that they were of the Puritan element. They had dedicated their lives to study of the letters. They were trained in textual criticism. They were the greatest linguists on the face of the earth. And it is said each passage of scripture was sent out by the committee all over the then known world to the most learned men on the face of the earth for consideration. And then only after each scripture was checked 14 times. I have the grid in my office. I try to hide it because if you show some people, they're going to steal the book from you. That's why I take it and it's hidden in my office. But I have the grid in my office. It was checked 14 times. There is a gentleman that served on that committee by the name of Dr. Lancelot Andrews. It is said that he spoke 11 languages with such efficiency and fluency that he could have served as the interpreter of tongues at the confusion of tongues of the Tower of Babel. Now that is an hyperbole, an exaggeration. But what I'm saying to you is that this is and how God used these people to bring the scriptures to us. And now we are here in the last of the church ages that we will get to on next week. Can the church say amen? If there are no questions, I would like to share with you a final note, and that is the 10th chapter of the book of St. Matthew, which apparently was somewhat misinterpreted in the early days of the church. Praise the Lord. Misinterpreted during the period of Thyatira, during the Dark Ages. Are you listening to me? Some refer to it as the medieval ages. This scripture is so very critical to the child of God. It's so very significant. When Jesus speaks in chapter 10, verse number 34, let's start with verse number 33. Let's start with verse number 32. If you have it, can you say amen? Amen. Let us read, "Whosoever therefore shall confess me before men, him will I confess also before my Father which is in heaven. But whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father which is in heaven. Think not that I am come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword." Now that sword is the word of God. Some have interpreted this that the church can go to war. No doubt this was a misinterpretation during the period of Catholic rule in which we went into what's called a 30 years war. It was thought that this scripture meant the church had a right to take up weapons and to go to war. This is not what this is referring to. The sword here is the word of God. If it had to do with taking up weapons and going to war, then Jesus had already said that my kingdom is not of this world. If it was, I'd call my angels and they would do what? They'd fight for me. We should understand, since I mentioned that, is that the Bible says that we have come in the 12th chapter of the book of Hebrews, that we have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, to an innumerable company of angels. We should understand that we do engage angels in our walk with God on a daily basis, though they are not visible to the naked eye. It is a mistake for the child of God to misunderstand that when we assemble ourselves in worship, angels are present with us. That is scriptural, even though I'm not teaching the Bible class tonight on the eruption of angels or what the scripture says concerning what is referred to in Wayne Grudem's book known as Systematic Theology as the Theology of Angels. What I will say to you is that it is ignorance on the part of the child of God not to realize that when you receive the baptism in Jesus' name and the baptism of the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost and you're walking with God, that there are not angels with you. And in fact, this is why so many of us are found to get out of so many unusual situations. And we wind up with such strange testimonies that are inexplicable by natural explanation. These accidents that we get out of us. The sister was hit, Sister McDonald was hit 5 times. These healings we come through. These experiences that we go through when we go to the hospital and God engages us in the operating room and God engages us in the recovery room and God brings us out and the person next to us dies and we live. I understand it's God, but in addition to that, the Bible is clear that angels are given as ministering spirits to those of us who are heirs of what? Salvation. So for us to dismiss benefits, this is what we do all the time. We dismiss all of these benefits as though they don't exist just because we can't see them with our naked eye. And it is a big mistake on the part of the apostolic Christian who's supposed to be so spiritual. If you're so spiritual, then why don't you believe what the scripture says? If we're so spiritual, why don't we recognize that when Brother Fitz falls asleep every time he goes to work, he gets there safely because there are angels with him in his vehicle? He's not going to turn to someone and say, he ain't the only one falling asleep in here. So God does not want, just like you want credit so you can get to heaven, God wants you to give him the proper credit for what he does for you and me. No one wants to stand before God and God forget about all the good things you did and say, well, who are you? You want credit for your good, and God wants to be praised and glorified for the good he does in the life of the child of God. Someone say angels. And so now, he did not come to send peace. A lot of us don't like to deal with conflict and controversy. We don't like to upset people. What he is saying is that when the sword or the word comes, it's going to upset some people. And you have to be ready to deal with people based on the sword. The word of the Lord is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. The word of God will cause division. It will cause conflict. And us going around trying to embrace everyone so that they can like us as apostolics is where we have failed and made our mistake. You can be nice to people. David Ellis was nice to people, but everyone knew that he was one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. Everyone knew that. They knew what he believed. They knew who he was. They knew what he stood for. And they knew he wasn't about to change for anybody. Now, if you don't have the tapes, I got the tapes in my office. I hide those too. Can we say amen? Because somebody will try to come get them too. Verse number 35, read, for I am come to set a man at variance against his father, and the daughter against her mother, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And what will it be over? It won't be over Christmas gifts. It won't be over money. It won't be over material things. It's going to be over the scriptures. The word where you stand on the scriptures. This is where you are supposed to be willing to draw a line in the sand with any and every person on the face of the earth. Because this has to do with you and your relationship with the Almighty God. And nothing should take precedence in the life of the apostolic Christian over their relationship with God. This is what Jesus is saying. Praise the Lord. And so now, verse number 36, he goes further. Read, a man's foes shall be they of his. And this is how it was during the period of Inquisition, both during pagan Rome and papal Rome, where many Christians gave their lives because of the position they took on the scriptures. 60 million is the number that is in John Fox's Book of Martyrs. 60 million Christians put to death because of the position they took on the scriptures. Now, we're not in the day that you have to give your life and die for it. We are in the day we have to give our life and what? We have to live for it. We have to give our bodies a what? A living sacrifice. So this is nothing so great for us to do. It's a small thing. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's a small thing. Get snooty. Stick your nose up in the air and say, it's a small thing. See, some of us have no dignity with God. Verse number 37, let's read. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy. If you're not willing to take a scriptural position that is in opposition to your mother and your father's position, when you know that God has revealed to you what his will is for your life, you're not worthy. If my relationship with my parents is more important than my relationship with God, I'm not worthy. Jesus severed his relationship with his family and his Jewish brothers and sisters so that he would give his life a ransom for the multitude. Praise the Lord. And he gave his life a ransom for many. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Verse 38, and he that taketh not his cross, this term here, this expression and statement by Jesus, and he that taketh not his cross, has to do with he that is not willing to repent. The cross he's referring to is repentance. The cross is the symbol of our repentance. He that taketh not his cross, and followeth after me is not worthy of me. The taking of our crosses means it means when we accept repentance, because we don't go and get nailed to a cross. But when we die, our death is repentance. Our burial is water baptism in Jesus' name. And our resurrection is receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost. So he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. Verse 39. And he that findeth his life shall lose it. Please think with me, if you will, in these last 5 minutes, as we said on Tuesday night, he that findeth his life. As we said, many people, yes, I don't know if you passed it out, make sure we pass that out to everyone that was here, even the ones that just came in. Many people will find their life in this world. They find the thing that they are best at. They find the thing there that they are able to manifest and maximize their skill set at. They find the things that are most precious to them in this life. They find the things that are most important to them. And it seems as though for many people, things fall in place. And many people are just satisfied having their life the way that they have found it to be, so palatable and so comfortable to them. But when God shows up in the life of persons who have found their life in this life, in this system, in this world. Notice what he says. Even if you find your life in this world, this system, in society, you're still going to lose it.